You're listening to the Bible teaching ministry of Pastor Ross Graham of Grace Bible Church, Kingswood, New South Wales, Australia. Ross will be using the inerrant Word of God to draw our truths in its original context. To find more messages like this, visit www.gracebiblechurchkingswood.org, or to join our online community, you can now find us on Facebook by searching for Grace Bible Church Kingswood. May this message today bless you, and as always, bring glory to God. Here's Pastor Ross.
Well, welcome tonight. It's good to see you all out. It's been a busy couple of days, but look, we just want to welcome you all, those of you who are here physically and those of you who are catching the service or the message at least online. And we want to begin with the singing of a wonderful song, and we want you to join us in that. The words will be up, of course, for those listening at home, but please join us in the song.
Oh.
Take your Bibles and turn to the 8th chapter of the book of Romans. We'll be working our way along through this particular passage tonight. And the reason that I have turned you to Romans chapter 8 is because Romans 8 shows us the span of God's love. Simultaneously lofty and near, are critical to cling to, but hard to contain. As big as the universe, yet intensely personal. This is our reality, and this is our real place in life. You see, we're in the midst of a series of messages about knowing God in the real places of life. God's love is immense. And God loves us with a gigantic love. And so I begin tonight with a question. Is there any force more powerful than the love of God? It can inspire anything from ballads to sonnets to refrigerator art. It has started wars, stopped feuds. It can make shy people babble and babblers speechless. Love is powerful. And God's love, church, I want you to understand this, is the most powerful of all. Now, I want to suggest that Romans 8 is one of these tether chapters. And I simply say that because throughout the ages, people have tethered their hearts to this passage in the precious Word of God, and the passage has returned the favor. You see, to know that God's love is active, to know that His love is infinite, to know that His love is everlasting, makes joys a whole lot sweeter and difficulties less painful, because His love rises above all of these things. And though the verse has often been misunderstood, though it's been misquoted, though it's been misrepresented down through time, a right understanding of Romans 8:28 uncovers God's character, uncovers His actions and motivation. This particular verse, Romans 8:28, out of the chute, is the carefully crafted summary for the verses that follow it. So I want you to just follow along, if you would, in your copy of God's inerrant word, the 28th verse. And here Paul says, "And we know," that means "and we know without any shadow of a doubt, that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose." Now, earlier in the letter, Paul wrote about suffering and he wrote about persecution. And here he reminded the church at Rome that the all-powerful, all-knowing, ever-present God is in charge of things. God takes all things, the best and the worst, every overwhelming enormity, and the smallest, tiniest detail in life, and He causes them all to work together for the good of His children. And this isn't denial on behalf of the part of the Apostle Paul. Paul wasn't saying that suffering and trials are good or they're only a toothless tiger. No, that wasn't what he was saying. He acknowledged in the Word of God and in other epistles that the evil of this world, he acknowledged that. But he reminded his readers that God is working behind the scenes. God is ever working behind the scenes for His chosen people. So let's read that verse again slowly. "And we know that in all things," not some things, not most things, "and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose." Now, in the next two verses, Paul set forth five truths about the people mentioned in that particular verse of Scripture. And these five are a package deal. They're unable to be divided. They're unable to be broken up. They build on one another progressively, increasing in good news for his children. And we read in the 29th verse to the 30th verse these words. For those God foreknew, he also predestined. Listen to what he predestined them to. He didn't predestine them to be saved. He predestined them, if you are a saved person, he predestined them to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified, says the precious, inerrant Word of God. And I don't know whether you realize it or not, but I want to tell you here tonight that these verses showcase God's love at work. It's His process. We contribute absolutely nothing. And Paul made, as he wrote under the inspiration of the Spirit of God, he made five declarations regarding what God has done for those who trust in Christ, for those who have believed, for those who have exercised faith in the finished work of the cross. Look at the words in the passage that show us God's love at work. You ready? Verse 29. The words foreknew and predestined appear. And then in verse 20, the words called and justified and glorified appear. So let's take a brief look at them. Foreknowledge, just like it sounds, means that God knew us before we were saved. Before we were born, before we were knit together in our mother's womb, before time began. God saw each of his own and he knew us absolutely, completely. Can I say that to you? Right out of the Word of God. Yes. God foreknew his children fully, personally, intimately, for all eternity. And then Paul wrote that God predestined those he foreknew. The verb in the Greek, proorizo, means to decide upon beforehand or to predetermine. And this has caused a lot of controversy in the church of the living God, and really I don't have a problem with it. For me, it's without controversy at all, because it is a sometimes incendiary term, and it means that God devised, simply means that God devised a plan for each of his children. And what is it? Well, I'm glad you asked. It's right there in the 29th verse. To be conformed, you see, to the image of his Son. To shape the lives of those who love him. To shape the lives of those who have trusted in the all-sufficient work of the cross along the same lines as the life of his Son. Hold your place in Romans 8 and find Ephesians chapter 1, a passage that... and don't lose your place in Romans 8, but find Ephesians 1. And zero in with your peepers on verses 4, 5, and 6, if you will. And here the scripture says, for he chose us in him. That's the key words, in him. He chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will. To the praise of his glorious grace, which he has, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. I mean, just think of that. We were chosen in Christ before the foundation of the world. To be adopted as adult sons in the family of God. That means having the full rights of sonship. all freely given to us to the praise of His glorious grace. And our hearts recognize that it was God's work every time. We thank Him for saving us. I thank Him all the time for saving a rebel sinner like me, for giving me the faith to place my trust in Him. And every time that we pray for someone else's salvation, I praise the Lord God. Now back to Romans 8. It's hard to comprehend, but we know that. Left to our own devices, we could not and would not have chosen God. The scripture says, there is none righteous, no, not one. No one seeks after God. And the truth is that God knew us all for eternity, and He decided that we would each be conformed to Christ when we come to Him. But it doesn't stop there. God also called His children. According to Romans 8, He invited them to be His. That's why you have to exercise faith when you hear the gospel. And those He called, the scripture says He also justified. And that word justified is not justified, never sinned. It's exactly the opposite. It means I have sinned, and God, in a sovereign act of mercy and grace, has declared me an unrighteous sinner, holy in His sight. And that word justifies is a long word meaning free of charges. So here's the truth of it all. We've got the guilt of sin racking up. And the truth of the matter is, it's absolutely more than you and I could ever pay. But fortunately, marvelously, grace-wise, those God foreknew, those God planned for and invited, He also found not guilty. Not guilty because Christ paid all of the penalties in our stead. Oh, what a Savior. He took our place on Calvary's cross, and God laid upon Him all of our sins. And finally, all those who have been foreknown, predestined to be conformed to the image of Jesus once they believe, those who have been called and justified, declared righteous, God will someday glorify. The Greek word for it is doxazo. And it means to clothe in splendor, to cause to have a splendid greatness in eternity. It's the same word used to describe how Christ's life glorified the Father. Like the shine of a newly polished silver, this glory is the shine of perfection, when no sin will tarnish us because Christ's salvation has rid us of every single solitary spot. If you are a blood-washed child of Jesus Christ in this church tonight, listen to me, you will never face judgment for sin because Jesus has been judged in your place. Hallelujah. What a message. Earlier in the chapter, Paul discussed the distress of the Christians in Rome. And in verses 28 through 30, Paul reminded them that God works, this is the passage that we've read thus far, that God works all things, including their current persecution and suffering, together for their good. Now listen to me carefully. The events of our lives are not ruled by chance or blind fate, but by our loving Lord and Savior, who works out His plan and His purpose in the lives of His children, and who is committed to conforming us to the glorious image of His Son. And in that conforming process, He will and may have to chip and push and prod and cut and hone in order to conform you to the image of Christ. And sometimes that can be painful. Paul reminded them here that God has chosen them in eternity past and he will glorify them in eternity future. What a day that'll be. Now, like Romans 8, 28 and through 30, verses 31 through 39 express five truths, this time stated as rhetorical questions. And they begin with a summary statement, and we find the summary statement written in verse 31. It says, "What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us?" What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? When Paul wrote, "What then shall we say in response to this?" he was referring to the five declarations that we've already looked at in verses 29 through 30. What followed was a response to and in light of those truths. And with these words, "If God is for us, who can be against us?" Paul summarized not only the rest of chapter 8, but also the shock of Christianity. Given all of these things, listen, God is for us. Think about that. Think about that. Have you ever really thought about that deeply? God, who created time, who holds the universe in place, who spoke the very creation into being, who hung the sun and the moon in the sky and flung the stars into the night sky, is for us. For Paul, for the Romans, for you. Glorious perfection is for you, the one who couldn't get out of bed this morning, who ran a red light yesterday, who was grumpy on Tuesday, or maybe who didn't do the dishes last night. Church, listen to me carefully. You need to claim it as your anthem. Tape it on your bathroom mirror. Never let go of the wonder that God is for you. Let's say it together. God is for me. God is for me. One more time. God is for me. One more time for the dummies. God is for me. Hallelujah. I didn't mean that, of course. So we now come to the first rhetorical question. The first question is this, we've already quoted it, if God is for us, who can be against us? If the powerful, loving God was for those believers in Rome, who was the Roman Emperor Nero in comparison? If God is for his children around the world, who are the persecutors of the church? If God is for us, who is Satan in comparison? Church, listen to me. No one can thwart God's plan or his people. No one. No power challenges them. No nemesis concerns them. Because he is for his children, there is no true threat to us either. Not even death. Verse 32, follow along. Copy of God's inerrant word. The scripture says, he who did not spare his own son but gave him up for all of us, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, but more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Question two. Will he not give us all things? Given the enormous, breathtaking act of the Father giving his Son to die for our salvation, listen, everything else is minor. If God loves us that much, he would not withhold what we need. If he's willing to go that far, would he stop there? Verse 32 says, he graciously gives us all things. That is, let me give you a direct translation. He freely gives. It's called grace. If God gives all things, and if he's on our side, and he is, then the corollary has to be that if he doesn't give us what we need and wanted, he has a reason full of love and purpose for it. You see, this isn't a vending machine verse promising all of our desires. It's a description of God's infinite grace and mercy. It's a description of God's generosity with the most sober sacrifice setting the standard. And even when we sit in church and sit in our lounge rooms and lay on our beds at night, even when we aren't recognizing it, listen to me, God is freely and abundantly providing the best for us. Even in the worst of our circumstances, he is working all things out together for the good. Hallelujah. Question three. Who will bring a charge against God's elect? Given all these things, whose accusation will stand in the court of our Father? Whose? He is the one who justifies us. No charges stick. No accusations succeed. Question four, who is the one condemning us? Who can bring charges to condemn us? You see, our hearts may be paralyzed by guilt. Our hearts might be paralyzed by shame. People might criticize the children of God, attack and slander us. And the enemy himself will condemn us. Yet the apostle of grace, Paul, says at the beginning of the chapter in Romans 8:1, and I love this verse, and you need to learn it yourself, therefore there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, none. Why? Because of the five truths. Because God is for us. Because he is the one who justifies us, and because Christ is the one who, verse 34, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Verses 35 through 39, if you will, follow along. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship? Or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, he says, in all of these things we are more than conquerors. We are more than conquerors, he said. We are more than conquerors. Through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Question five. Who will separate us? from the love of Christ. In the sea of our troubles, or the sea of troubles that was the Romans' reality, they were going through persecution. And in our own, the fifth question appears like a rescue boat. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? You see, Paul built up to this, laying down layers of lessons. It's God, not us, who initiates our relationship. It's God, not us, who protects us, provides for us, defends us. And then he noted, it is not our power, but God's that keeps us in the love of Christ. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Well, many of us are removed from the things Paul listed. We've really never known it much in this country: tribulation, distress, and persecution. Don't forget, they were very real to the original readers of this letter. They were going through that: famine, nakedness. These were difficulties that they faced in their faith, not symbols of problems, peril, the sword. Paul quoted from Psalm 44:36. He said, "For your sake we face the death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered." You see, for God's sake, they were being martyred. It was an absolute reality to them back in that first century. Yet even in this context, Paul called Roman believers to see from the eternal perspective. And as believers in Christ, that's what we need to view life with, from the perspective of eternity. Not the circumstances that we're in, which we are in now, but with eternal perspectives. In all things, not despite them, in all things, he says, we are more than conquerors. We overwhelmingly conquer. Now, they probably related much easier to sheep being slaughtered because they were going through much tribulation than that they related to being conquerors, yet that is exactly what they were. They were men and women of faith who were loved by God, who gave them exactly what they needed for their day, and they conquered through him who loves them and who loves us. Now, lest we believe that there's any exception to that, Paul made it clear that there is nothing that can separate us from God's love. Say it with me: nothing. One more time: nothing. You've got it. Follow along verse 38 one more time. Lest you believe there's any exception, and there's not. He says, "For I am convinced," now listen, "that neither death can't do it, nor life, that can't do it, neither angels nor demons, they can't do it, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, they can't do it. Neither height nor depth nor anything else," listen, "in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." As verse 39 shows, the Father's love is inextricably tied to Jesus. All that we read in Romans 8 is accessible to all who are in Christ. But that's not true universally, because a lot of people are not in Christ. Nothing can overturn the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. However, the unconditional love of the Father is accessed only on the condition of salvation provided in his Son. That's what makes us his children. John 14:6, Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." And listen, no one comes to the Father except through me. You have to exercise faith. And what does that look like? That if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You see, God's love is so powerful, it could only be initiated and preserved by an all-powerful being. It's so everlasting, only an eternal deity could love that way. It's pure as only a holy God could maintain. And it's abundant as only an infinite Father could love. So may you, in terms of Ephesians 1 or Ephesians 3, be able to take in with all Christians the extravagant dimensions of Christ's love. Reach out and experience the breadth, test the length, plumb the depths. Rise to the heights. Live full lives, full in the fullness of God, through the effectual, working, dynamic power of the Holy Spirit as Jesus Christ lives his life through us. Oh, what a Savior. What a Savior. What blessings we have. Never to be separated from the love of God in Christ because we have trusted in him. Amen and amen. Hope you really will enjoy our closing song.
My life was filled with darkness, and no matter where I turned, there was no light. In my desperation and loneliness, I cried out in the night. And I know there's a God. Lord, I know you're out there somewhere. Please come tonight. As I fell to my knees, I felt the power of the love I call the saving kind. The brightest light I've ever seen was shining. The warmest breeze was flowing through my life. The greatest peace I've ever known has filled me. Ever since I felt the power of the love I call the saving kind. When life gets you down, and no matter who you're with, you're still alone. And you know there must be more to life than feeling like you're far away from. finding everlasting peace of mind. Well, believe me when I tell you that the love you're needing now's the saving kind. The brightest light
Thank you for tuning in to Pastor Ross Graham, and for more information about his ministry, visit www.gracebiblechurchkingswood.org. Until next time, God bless.